my God is with me, and if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high, every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. You keep on loving and you never let go. Singing, oh no, you never let go through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, you never let go in every high, every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on.
Age to age, he stands. Good morning, congregation. Welcome to all worshiping with us today. We welcome the friends and family of Trid Barda as she makes profession of faith this morning. We welcome Pastor Jeff and Pastor Frank as they lead our morning service. The children aged 3 to 8 will be dismissed following the children's message led by Pastor Jeff. If you have not yet filled out the affirmation list for office bearers, please take a moment this week. The link was emailed out and there are hard copies on the Welcome Center. Our offerings today will be received during the service for Bethel Ministries in the black bag and Senior Support Services in the burgundy bag. A few last minute announcements were handed to me this morning, so bear with me. Next week is Soup Sunday. We are still looking for 10 pots of soup. If you are able, please sign up in the church basement on the bulletin board. Many hands make light work. Dunnville Christian School Booster Club invites you to their annual fundraising dinner on Saturday, April 20th. The doors open at 5:30 and dinner is at 6. If you'd like to join us for a delicious home-cooked meal and award-winning comedy entertainment, please contact Cassandra Snippa or Nellie DeClerc by Wednesday, April the 10th. A free will donation to DCS is encouraged at the end of the evening. So that's Saturday, April 20. The Grand River Prayer Breakfast will be held Saturday, April 27th from 8 to 10 a.m. The speaker is Pastor Steve DeBoer, who heads our classes ministry, The Bridge, in Niagara Falls. He is speaking on a shining hope into our community, and the deadline for tickets is this Friday. Please contact Otto Bulk or Clarence Hauer for tickets. The proceeds will go towards the Bridge Ministry. So that's the 27th, the week after. Everyone is invited to join us this evening at 7 p.m. as Pastor Jeff leads our service. And everyone is welcome to gather downstairs this morning for refreshments following the service. May we be blessed as we worship together. Thank you.
Thank you, Jordan. It is indeed a pleasure to gather as God's people this morning, a special occasion, and we're grateful for those who have joined us and to witness and participate alongside us, alongside those who are worshiping online with us and not able to get here physically, but certainly here in spirit. And in that spirit, our call to worship comes from Psalm 133. How good and pleasant it is when brothers live together and sisters, live together in unity. And it's like a precious oil poured out on the head, running down the beard, running down on Aaron's beard, down the collar of his robes, as if the dew of Hermon were falling on Mount Zion. For there the Lord bestows his blessing, even life forevermore. Let's join our hearts in prayer. Dear Lord, this morning we are gathered together. We saw the sun rise this morning, and it was only a week ago where we celebrated the rising of the sun, your son, Jesus, and Resurrection Sunday, Easter. And yet, Lord, we live in the power of that resurrection, and we celebrate the opportunity to gather together to be one with each other here in this place and wherever technology allows us to this to be shared. Father, we know that your spirit is not bound by four walls or by the distance or time. And we pray that your spirit infuses all those who are participating this morning with a rich measure of your presence, of your comfort, of your peace, as we gather in this place to celebrate, to hear your word, to lift our praises, and to express the prayers of our hearts. We pray, Father, that you will continue to be with us this day, be with all those who need you in a special way, and give them what they stand in need of. And in this your name we pray, all saying together, amen. Invite you to stand if you're able to receive God's greeting this morning as we've gathered in his place, in his house. He greets us with these words, grace, mercy, and peace be to you. In the name of God our Father, through Jesus Christ, his Son, in the presence and power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Praise is rising. Lord, I need you. Let's lift our hearts in song.
Oh,
There's been a wordplay that we've used in along the way between Chronos time and Kairos time. Chronos time being the circular time on a clock. It extends from yesterday to today to tomorrow. Kairos time being that time that God has ordained, that moment which has arrived, regardless of where it was on the clock on the schedule. And by Chronos time, we've been waiting for this opportunity for some time. But by Kairos time, this is exactly the time that God has ordained for us to be here and to witness the profession of faith of Trid and to celebrate God's goodness. And to say that this is an answered prayer by Chronos time, it's been a long time. And so we've appreciated the faithfulness of the prayers, but also the faithfulness of God to recognize and to hold us tight, even when personally we seem to have walked away His relationship is not our most important, but God doesn't forget. God is faithful all the time, regardless of which time we're referring to. And so I'd like to lead you in a short form. There'll be some questions and answers for Trid, and we'll have an opportunity to pray with her and to celebrate the goodness of God in her life. And she's got a story, and she'll be glad to tell you when you have a chance to have coffee with her, and it's a good story. Congregation of our Lord Jesus Christ, today we are privileged to welcome into the full life of the church's fellowship Astrid Barda, who wishes to confess her faith in Christ as Lord and Savior. When she was baptized, God made clear his claim on her as his own. And she was received into the church. Now she wishes to share fully in the life of this congregation and indeed the whole church of God. And so today she will publicly accept and confirm that was sealed in her baptism and confess her faith in the Lord Jesus, offer herself as a willing servant. And we thank God for having given her this desire and pray that now as we hear her confession, he will favor us with the presence and guidance of his Holy Spirit. Astrid, at this time I'll ask you to stand, and I will read the four questions and ask for your response at the end. Do you, Astrid Barda, believe in that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, sent to redeem the world? Do you love and trust him as the one who saves you from your sin? And do you, with repentance and joy, embrace him as Lord of your life? Do you believe that the Bible is the Word of God, revealing Christ and his redemption? And the confessions of this church faithfully reflect that revelation. Do you accept the gracious promises of God sealed to you in your baptism? And do you affirm your union with Christ and his church, which your baptism signifies? And finally, do you promise to do all that you can with the help of the Holy Spirit to strengthen your love and commitment to Christ by sharing faithfully in the life of the church, honoring and submitting to its authority? Do you join with the people of God doing the work of the Lord everywhere? Pastor, what's your answer? Lord helping. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, I now welcome you into the privileges of full communion. I welcome you to full participation in the life of the church. I welcome you to its responsibilities, its joys, its sufferings. May the God of peace, who through the blood of the eternal covenant brought back from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, may he equip you to do for everything good for doing his will. And may he work in us what is pleasing to him through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. Amen. Congregation, I invite you to stand with Trid and express together with one voice. Thanks be to God. We promise you our love, encouragement, and prayers. And while we're standing, let's share in the Apostles' Creed, saying together what we believe.
I believe in God the Father. You may sit down, not you. Come and join me up here. Turn around. For those of you who have been asking this morning, who is Trid Barda anyway? This is Trid Barda. Well, just stand. Yep. So I have a little devotional for you. This is a compact one. You can put this one right in the vest when you're going in the truck. And today is, the reading is our text for today, for April 7th. And so this has a text for every day. And so as you go through, you can take that and appreciate that. And a small representation of today's activities. And as we're going to offer a prayer, and as we do so, invite any family, friends that would like to come forward and share this time with Trid, come on up. Office bearers, Paul, of course. Come on down. Let's ask God's blessing today. Dear Lord, as we are gathered here with hands raised and hands laid on, we thank you for your blessings. We know that there is no wrong time. This is the right time. And we are grateful that your Spirit has infused Trid with a desire to be part of our community, that she's answered the call that you've placed on her heart. And there's no best before date on that call, Lord. We know that whenever we receive it, you are willing and able to receive us with open arms, and we are grateful for your faithfulness. Father, we ask that you will continue to bless Trid. This is not the end of her journey, but another step, another milestone in the walk that she has, the call that has been placed on her life. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to walk with her, to strengthen her, to encourage her, be there for her when life is hard and struggles seem to overwhelm and it takes too long at the border. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to be with her and to give her what she stands in need of, and all those who are gathered here with her, to strengthen and encourage her, to lift her up when she's down. And Lord, we pray that in all things we give glory and honor to your name. And in this your name we pray, all saying together, amen. You may be seated. And Trid has chosen a song which we're going to join in together, 10,000 Reasons.
Thank you.
this time, we'll have a children's message with Pastor Jeff. So invite children to come forward and come on down.
Yeah, a little bit. Morning. Morning, guys. Morning, Mr. Buist. There's lots of room, so if you see someone standing around looking for a space, maybe you could move over and let your friend sit beside you. There we go. Come on, Colin. There we go. Okay, let's there's a second row of bleachers back there. There we go. Okay, I have something to share with you this morning that I received over 50 years ago. And it's a letter from my great grandpa, my opa, Jacob van Groep, okay? Long time ago. Now, I was just in fourth grade. It was 1973, so I was 9 years old, so I was just a little bit older than you were. And my teacher, I went to grade school, yeah, grade four. I was in grade four, okay, Tice? All right, so I was in school in Woodstock, which is a city or a town a little ways away, and my teacher, her name was Mrs. Rita Klute, and she lives in Simcoe now. Mrs. Klute gave us a challenge as a classroom to write some poems. And so I wrote a poem about the water. And she liked it so much that she said, well, we should send it to this fine arts festival that we used to do back in the day. And everybody there liked it so much that they gave me a prize. And my mom and dad were so impressed, my opa and oma in Van Dalen in Woodstock were so impressed, they said, you should send a copy of your poem to your great opa in the Netherlands, because he wasn't feeling very well. Anyway, we did that, and my opa then sent me a letter. Now, Otto, come here. Can you read that? Not a chance, right? Me either. Opa's language, he lived in a town of Gouda, and he says, dear great grandson, I don't know why, I'll just put the accent in there. My dear grandson, Jeffrey. And we both great grandmas and your two aunts are really surprised that Opa and Oma got these letters, my poem. Well, Jeff, I'm happy at home after a couple of weeks in the hospital on account of my heart. He wasn't feeling very well, and he was so impressed that he sent me this letter. And on the back, in Dutch, he also added a poem of his own. I have no idea what it says. But somebody in this room probably knows how to read Dutch. And maybe they can help me out after the service. But anyway, did you know that I never, in my whole life, I never saw my Opa van der Hoek. I never saw Opa Jacob. And I never shook his hand. I never saw him smile. I never sat on his lap. I never sat at table and heard him pray. And yet, I know that my opa loves me. Because I got this letter. So, why is that important to me? You know, we've not seen Jesus. He's here with us, but we've never seen him smile at us. We've never shook his hand or received a hug from Jesus. And yet we know that Jesus loves us because of God's letter to us, the Bible, right? And isn't there a song that we sing, Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. That's right, Tice. The Bible tells me so. So, do you think this is an important letter for us to keep? Yeah. Is it an important letter for us to maybe even read it a lot? Yeah, it is. Is it an important letter for us? Is it an important book for us to maybe even memorize some words? Like, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, but have everlasting life. Those are some good words for us to remember. So I want you today to go to Sunday school this morning and remember the good things that God has told you about Jesus in the Bible. And I want you to listen to your teachers. I want you to pay attention to what they have to say because it's very, very important. It'll help you grow big and strong and to know Jesus loves you with his whole being. So I'm going to ask you to fold your hands and close your eyes, and we're going to pray for a moment, and then we're going to give the congregation our blessing. Let's close our eyes. Close our eyes. Fold our hands. Almighty God, we thank you for this day. And we thank you that you love us so much that you made this book, this letter to us, and reminded us that you are the God through all of time. And that in the middle of all of that time, you sent your son Jesus to break through our sin, to break through our stubbornness, and to remind us that you are a God of love and you want us to be your loving people as well. So we thank you for forgiving our sins and setting us on the right path. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So could you stand up, please? And do you remember what we're going to say? We're going to, on the count of three, okay? And then our moms and dads and our friends back there are going to respond to. So, one, two, three. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Okay. So somebody gets to hold the candle today for this side, and somebody gets to hold the candle for that side, and we get to walk to Sunday school and have a great, blessed day. And we want to invite Pastor Frank to lead us in prayer at this time.
Let's give them a moment to make their way. Let's join our hearts together as we bring our prayers and petitions to our Lord. Lord, on this day, we know we don't need to inform you of what's going on in our world. We don't need to inform you of what's going on in our hearts. We don't need to inform you of the blessing that we have received from you. These are all things which you know. And yet you call us. You invite us into relationship. You invite us into a conversation, an opportunity for us to share what's on our hearts and to hear from you through our prayer time what you would have us feel, hear, know. And Lord, we know that doesn't depend on my words. Your spirit is not bound by what I say. We know that you are, even right now, speaking to each one of us, calling us, reminding us, encouraging us,
correcting us, strengthening us in all things, and we are grateful. And we are particularly grateful for this day when we can celebrate with Trid, the long-awaited but yet perfectly timed profession of her faith, and that realization that you are a good God who is faithful to us, and that you keep knocking even when we've closed the door. And Lord, we pray that in all things we might open that door for you, and that we might allow you to enter into our lives more fully, not just at arm's length or through the words of someone whom we know, but a personal, direct, intimate relationship. And that's what you've called us to, Lord, that intimacy of one-on-one. And so we are grateful for that reminder today and that encouragement that we receive from knowing that your Spirit is still at work, still calling people to you, and still encouraging and reminding us of that relationship call. And yet, Lord, in our brokenness, in our sin, we fall short. We don't answer the knock on the door. We hold ourselves apart. We don't know why, but that's the result of a sin in our heart, Lord, that brokenness. And that falls into so many different categories. And one of the areas which we see that most clearly is in our broken bodies and the inability to live long and in the ways in which we would like to, which way we feel led to. But the brokenness of our bodies intercedes, and that illness and disease and lack of energy, all those ways in which that our fragile bodies break down. So we ask you to be with especially Jim and Irene as they celebrate today, but also knowing that Jim's not at home right now. He's in a new spot, and that can be challenging, but we pray that you will continue to be with him, grant him healing for the sores in his body, and that he will regain strength and the ability to see the good where he is. And we ask you to be with George and Rose, who are struggling with a number of health ailments, and Joe and Margaret's asthma, and to be specifically with Joe, who is struggling with breathing and low energy, and Lord, that makes every day a challenge. But Lord, we ask you to be with Anthony, who is struggling with his health, that cancer is continuing to grow, and that you know whatever days you have ordained for him, Lord, that you will continue to give him peace and comfort and strength that he may enjoy each day that you have enabled, that you have put him for him on this life. And we'd be happy with George Brower and those who care for him as this young man struggles with something that's not his fault. It's not anything he did. And yet, Lord, we know he's challenged with the issues that he's got. And right now to be with Josh and Annika as they care for him and with all the family around them, Lord, be with them. Give them what they stand in need of. And if it be your will, Lord, provide healing. Strengthen the muscles in his body that he can continue to grow and to return the love that you have for him to those around him. Lord, we ask you to be with those who are in long-term care. As we just mentioned, Jim, we know that there are others, Tina, Greta, Nolan, Margaret, Lorianne, and others who are in long-term care. Be with their caregivers. Give them what they stand in need of. And Lord, as we shared about the brokenness already, we know we don't have to tell you about the brokenness of war and all the different ways and areas which that has, we are experiencing that right now through the Middle East and through Eastern Europe, Ukraine and Russia And Lord, through the West Africa and the Sudan and all the areas, all the loss of life, so tragic, Lord, we pray that you will bring peace. Bring peace that we can carry on our lives without the worry about whether this will be our last day or not. So, Father, in all these things, we ask that you will lift us up. Give us what we stand in need of. We ask that you will continue to be with Senior Support Services as we collect an offering this morning that will help to support them in their care for seniors. And Lord, as we open your word, may that word be a light unto our path. May that lift us even closer, that love letter that you wrote to us so many years ago, which is just as intimate and personal to us today. Lord, may that be a shining light as we go forward in this day. And in this, your name we pray. Amen. Invite the deacons at this time to come forward and receive the offering for Senior Support Services.
As the deacons are making their way through the seats in our praise team, we'll do the same. There was a pair of glasses that were found outside, and they're going to be over here. So when you shake in Trid's hand later, come on by and pick them up. Otherwise, we'll just leave them with the church office, and you can pick up those things when you need it. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from John chapter 20. And our catechism lesson is Heidelberg Catechism, Lord's Day 13, question and answer 33 and 34. Let's read the catechism first. I'll ask the question, and then you can respond in kind. The question is, why is he called God's only son when we also are God's children? Together?
Are adopted children of God, adopted by grace through Christ.
Why do you call him our Lord?
Because not with gold or silver, but with his precious blood, he has set us free from sin and from the tyranny of the devil, and has bought us body and soul to be his very own.
In John chapter 20, verses 19 through 31, those words are on in your Bibles, but also on the screen before you. On the evening of that first day of the week, when the disciples were together, with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And after he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, one of the 12, was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "Hey, we've seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. There was a story told that was told of a young boy. He was raised in a rural town, perhaps such as Dunnville. He was raised by his grandmother. And one night, the house caught fire. And the grandmother tried to rescue the boy who was asleep in the bedroom upstairs, but she was so overcome by the smoke that she died tragically. Now, a small town didn't have much of a fire department. A crowd had gathered around the house, and they heard a small boy crying for help. The lower floor was just a wall of flames, and no one seemed to know what to do. And suddenly, a man, he just pushed his way through the crowd and climbed up one of those old iron drainage pipes which ran down from the roof, and the fire was hot, and the man, he made it to the second floor window, and he crawled through the window, and he located the boy, and with a crowd cheering encouragement, the man climbed back down with the boy on his back, and the boy's arms just wrapped around the man's back. A few weeks later, a public meeting was held to determine in whose custody the boy would be placed. Each person who wanted to care for the boy was allowed to make a brief statement. The first man said, "Well, I've got a farm, and I would give the boy a good home. He'd grow up in the farm, and he'd learn a trade." The second person made it up to the microphone. He said, or she said, "Well, I'm a school teacher, and I'd like to see it that this boy would receive a good education, so I'm willing to take him into my family." And finally, the local banker said, "Mrs. Morton and I would be able to give the boy a fine home and a good education. We'd like him to come to our home and live with us." And then the presiding officer just looked around and asked, "Is there anyone else who would like to say anything?" And then from the back row, a man rose and he said,
While these other people may be able to offer some things, but I can't, that I can't, all I got is my love. And he slowly removed his hands from his coat pockets, and a gasp went up from the crowd because his hands were still scarred from climbing up and down the burning house. And the boy recognized the man as the one who had saved his life, and the little boy just ran into his waiting arms. You know, the farmer, the teacher, and the banker, they just simply sat down, and everyone in the room knew what the decision would be. Because the scarred hands proved that this man had given more than all the others. The scarred hands proved that this man had given more than all the others. When I first read the words of this story, I couldn't help but think about Jesus' words to Thomas. Put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting. Believe. I think about what happened that first Easter Sunday. You know, Jesus rose from the dead. You know, that's quite the miracle, don't you think? I mean, Jesus died from a Roman crucifixion, but only to live a few days later. That would be quite the surprise, wouldn't it? I mean, that sort of thing just doesn't happen every day, does it? And yet there he is, Jesus Christ, rose from the dead, and his scars are his testimony of his love. We've all heard the story of Jesus' resurrection before. It was a Sunday night. The disciples had gathered together. They were afraid of the Jews, so they locked all the doors of the house. But somehow Jesus entered. He stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he showed them his hands and his side. Think about what happened that first Easter Sunday. Peter and John had seen the empty tomb. Mary Magdalene had seen the Lord, dismayed at first, but then she gathered herself and she passed on Jesus' message to the disciples, telling them that Jesus would soon return to the Father. But even so, telling them those things, the disciples still had not yet fully realized that Jesus had risen indeed from the dead. They were afraid of what the temple leaders might do to them. They were his followers. So they secluded themselves behind locked doors. Now the locked doors might have been able to keep the prying eyes of the religious leaders of Jerusalem from seeing them, but they could not exclude the risen Lord. The Bible tells us that Jesus came and stood among them. He said, "Peace be with you." And Jesus' sudden appearance to his disciples demonstrated that in his resurrected state, he was no longer bound by earthly limitations. Even though the disciples had abandoned Jesus at the cross, Jesus came to them and offered a restored relationship. "Peace be to you." You know, his scars are a testimony of his love. The disciples saw their master, their rabbi, their teacher with their own eyes. And the disciples were overjoyed. They were exuberant. Again, Jesus said, "Peace to you." And then he added a few more words. He said, "Just as the Father sent me, I'm going to send you." So he took a deep breath and breathed on them. "Receive the Holy Spirit," he said. "If you forgive someone's sins, they're gone for good. But if you don't forgive them their sins, what are you going to do with them?" And all this happened without Thomas being in the room with them. The disciples went out and told Thomas the good news. "Hey, we saw the master." To which Thomas replied, "Well, unless I see the nail holes in his hands and put my finger in the nail holes and stick my hand in his side, I'm not going to believe it." I mean, his teacher had been crucified on a cross. His His teacher had died. His teacher had been placed in a grave. And Thomas's heart was broken. Now, Thomas was not some hard-boiled rationalist who said, I don't believe that Jesus lives, and just starts looking for an argument. That's not Thomas. Thomas was hurt. And he said, I don't believe it, but I'm willing to believe if I can see it for myself. You know, Thomas had seen many of Jesus' great miracles. He had seen many people who had been healed by Jesus. He was a witness. He was there. But to believe in Jesus' resurrection, well, that one was just a little bit too big to handle. You know, I can't just believe because you said so. So he said, unless I see the nail holes in his hands and put my fingers in those holes and stick my hand into his side, I'm not going to believe it. Thomas was just not satisfied with the testimony of the others. Lots of people have seen lots of things, and Thomas had to see for himself. So then the Bible tells us, 8 days later, Jesus' disciples were again in the room, and this time Thomas was with them. And Jesus came through those locked doors. He stood among them and said, peace be with you. Then he focused his attention right on Thomas. Take your finger and examine my hands. Take your finger and stick it into my side. Don't be unbelieving. Believe. And the effects of Jesus' words were immediate. His scars were a testimony of his love. And Thomas said to Jesus, my Lord and my God. The scarred hands had proved what Jesus had done. The place where the soldier pierced Jesus' side had proved what Jesus had done. Thomas was no longer, he didn't need to place his finger in the nail holes in Jesus' hands or within the hole in Jesus' side. Seeing was believing. My Lord and my God. Thomas professed his faith in Jesus Christ. Now, Thomas's words were the last of all the confessions of Jesus found in the Gospel of John. John chapter 1, John the Baptist testified that Jesus is the Son of God. John chapter 1, Nathanael declared, Rabbi, you are the Son of God, you are the King of Israel. Chapter 4, the Samaritans. We know that this man is the Savior of the world. Chapter 9, a man born blind. He said, if this man were not from God, he could do nothing. And later that man worshiped him as the son of man. Martha said, chapter 11, she said, I believe that you are the Christ, the Son of God, who has come into the world. Chapter 16, the disciples said, this makes us believe that you came from God. Thomas' confession, my Lord and my God, was not only the last confession in John's gospel, it was perhaps also the greatest confession, because Thomas confessed that Jesus was not only his Lord, but also his God. And so that's a real strongly personal confession. And by recording that confession, the Apostle John brings us back to the very opening verses, the opening verse of the Gospel of John, where John wrote the words, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. My Lord and my God, Thomas professed. Jesus told him, because you've seen me, you've believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. And Thomas came to believe because he saw Jesus as the risen Lord. And then if you notice in the reading this morning, Jesus did not praise Thomas and his faith journey. Instead, Jesus pronounced a blessing on people like you And people like me, people who have not seen the risen Jesus Christ and yet believe in him anyway. And this was the very purpose the Apostle John wrote the gospel. That's why it's written. These words are for each of you gathered here this day. John wrote, Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in this book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. You are mentioned in the Bible. You. And these words of God are written for you, each of you, so that you may know that his scars are a testimony of his love for you. So then you should, at the very least, you know, read these words and value these words, because these words were written for you. Should hold them dearly. Cherish them. Keep them. Because they are for you. And these words from the Apostle John to you, you will come to understand who Jesus was, is, and always shall be. If you read the whole Gospel of John, you will come to understand that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whosoever believed in him should not perish but have eternal life. You will come to understand that Jesus is the bread of life. Jesus is the food for the body, food for your soul, food for your spirit. You will come to understand that Jesus is the light of the world. He is the Messiah, the promised one of the Old Testament. Every day the sun rises, and it reminds you that it is there. So it is, brothers and sisters, with Jesus. Jesus is the door. And you know, that might seem strange at first, but you come to know that Jesus is the only means of coming home to God. Jesus is the good shepherd. He's the one who leads you along the path of life to places of abundance, places of rest. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. Jesus has the power lodged within his own scarred hands to raise you back to life for life eternal. Jesus is the way, the truth, and the life. Jesus doesn't want you to be troubled in this life. Jesus is, in fact, preparing you for, you know, lifelong before you face death. Jesus is even now putting your troubled heart at ease, helping you grow in confidence, knowing that Jesus is the initiator and the sustainer and the keeper of your life itself. Jesus is the vine, and Jesus encourages you and me to live and remain and make your home in him. Jesus is inviting you to have an ongoing, active, life-giving connection to him. You are in the Bible. You are in God's word. Jesus performed many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not recorded in his book. But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is Messiah, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. You are written in the very words of God. These words are for you, so that you may know that his scars are a testimony of his love for you. So then, brothers and sisters, adopted children in the family of God, hold these words dear and cherish them and treasure them and appreciate them and keep them and know them and put them to memory, share them so that God receives the glory for the great things he has done in your life. God's people say, amen. Let's go to our God in prayer. Lord God Almighty, we give you thanks that you have graciously received us as adopted children into your forever family, all because of Jesus Christ. We know that because of his scars, you tell us that you love us. So then, Lord, help us then to value your word and read it every day. May we hear your word. May we know your word. May we live your word. May we reflect your word in our daily lives so that others may know you as the God of love and sacrifice, so that we may give you glory because of his scars. You have bought us, body and soul, to be your very own. So may we rest this Sabbath day in the truth of your word. Lord God Almighty, bless these, your people, as they go home. Bless them as they gather at their tables and receive the food that you have provided. Bless them as they open your word and pray to you and show their devotion to you, not just today, but every day. Bless your people as they go to bed at night. Bless their thoughts. Bless their prayers. Bless their dreams. Bless their awakening, knowing that each day and every day and every breath is a gift from you. Give each of us a sense of purpose and meaning in this world. And may the work of our hands and hearts bring glory to your most holy name. This we pray in the mighty name of Jesus, our Lord and God. Amen. It seems appropriate that when I started preaching, the clock stopped. How are we doing on Chronos time? Perfect, thank you. Perfect? It doesn't matter because it's all Kairos time, right? There we go. All right. We're going to sing a song and invite you to stand and sing with us. No longer slaves, I am a child of God.
Thank you.
children of our Lord and God, receive God's peace. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. My friends, may you grow in grace. Love and serve the Lord.